We are about to start, sir. Okay. A very pleasant good evening, everyone. I am Partha from the Biomics team. Would like to welcome you all for today's talk. The speaker of today's talk is Dr. Praveen Rahe. He is currently working as a scientist in National Center for Microbial Resources at National Center for Cell Sciences in Pune at India. He will be delivering his talk on Photomicrobiome, a reservoir for sustainable agriculture. On behalf of the Biomics team, I would like to welcome our eminent resource person, Dr. Praveen Rahe. Our speaker is an eminent scholar in the area of plant sciences and rhizobia biology. Henceforth, I believe that he would be nourishing you all through his talk. At this juncture, I would like to thank Professor Dr. Praveen Rahe for accepting my invitation and taking the time out of his busy schedule to join with us. It's a highly honor for our Biomics team in hosting this webinar with eminent resource person. And I also appreciate and welcome all the participants internationally across the world who joined with us through this talk. Dear participants, we have question and answer session at the end of this presentation. You are supposed to place your questions in the chat box. Myself here to put your questions to our guest speaker during question and answer sessions. And also you can place your feedback as comments in the same chat box. Before we start the session, it's my pleasure in taking credit of introducing our speaker, Dr. Praveen Rahe. Dr. Praveen Rahe is currently working as a scientist in National Center for Microbial Resources at National Center for Cell Science in Pune, at India. He obtained his doctorate in PhD microbiology in CSIR Institute of Himalayan Bioresources Technology, Balampur, in India. His research interests are to decipher the evolutionary relationship among the legume rhizobia, particularly crop legumes, and rhizosphere microbiome, and MALD TOF MS based microbial identifications. He has revealed the biogeographic patterns of distribution of different sublineages of P. rhizobia in the different agroclimatic regions of India. The overall scientific goal of his research is to harness the microbiome of plants to increase farm productivity via increasing nutrient uptake and cycling and resistance of different incidents. He is also interested in the reduction of objectionable microorganisms, which can either cause illness or degrade the products, identifying them up to species and subspecies levels, and to know which place they prefer to proliferate could provide crucial information to develop highly sufficient strategies to control microbial infections and contaminations. This research on microbial diversity associated with cellular phones led to the discovery of three new microbial species. Recently, this group described a new species of Leptella is isolated from stomata skin. He has awarded with many professional awards. A few are listed as International Travel Award in 2018 from the Department of Science and Technology from the Government of India. International Travel Award in 2015 from the Department of Biotechnology, Government of India. AIM Associate Life Sciences 2015 Maharashtra from Academy of Sciences, Pune in India. AIM Scientist Award in Agriculture Microbiology in 2013 in Association of Microbiologists of India. International Travel Award in 2010, Department of Sciences Technology from the Government of India. With this brief intro, may I now request Dr. Praveen Rahe to deliver a talk on Phytomicrobiome, a reservoir for sustainable agriculture. Sir, over to you.
Okay. Thank you, Partha, and the entire team of Biomics, and all the participants, those who are watching us on YouTube, I guess. I welcome you all. And Today, I chose this topic for my presentation. It's phytomicrobiome, a reservoir for sustainable agriculture. So when we talk about sustainable agriculture, first we have to know the history of agriculture, because we know that history paves path for the future of agriculture. So humans invented agriculture during Neolithic era, which occurred between somewhere between 7,000 to 10,000 years ago. And that time there were only 8 Neolithic crops these people were cultivating, which includes 2 wild wheat varieties, peas, lentils, vetch, barley, pea, chickpeas, and flax. With these systems, with the development of agriculture system, since then it became the mainstay for all human civilizations. And we are aware of this, that in our human history there were many collapses of human civilizations in different timelines, and many of these collapses are associated with degradation of soil ecosystems, which lead to the failure of agriculture in those civilizations. So the first one, I have highlighted few of the examples here, like civilization of Sumerians in Mesopotamia, somewhere around 10,000 BC, lead to collapses due to the salinization of their agriculture soils. In our Indian subcontinent, the Harappan civilization in the Indus Valley region, somewhere around 2000 BC, collapsed due to desiccation and desertification. We are aware of that. That was because of certain changes, geological changes in the Himalayan regions, which led to the drying of many river systems, and without water, the soils became dry and there was desertification. So similarly, there were many other civilizations which collapsed due to some one or other cause of soil degradation or ecological degradations. Somewhere in 1960s, the Green Revolution changed our agriculture system with the improved agriculture practices, which includes soil management through addition of chemical fertilizers, which provide instant nutrients to the plants, crop plants, and which ultimately led to the increase in yields, and development of plant genetics, which lead to the development of many hybrid varieties, which are high yielding crops. And all these systems, they lead to very increase in yields and made world free from food scarcity. So with this Green Revolution, we also faced several challenges like soil salinity, salinization, deforestation, urban sprawls, land degradation, and erosions. So if we look into the, if we talk about sustainable agriculture or sustainable system, we need to fix resilience with the ecosystem and the nature, and develop our cultivation programs in a way that will not harm the agriculture soils. So if the soils are healthy, we consider there will be no, it will lead to sustainable development. So in somewhere in 2015, UN member of UN United Nations, they came together and developed sustainable development goals, which include 17 goals. And if we fix the soil health issue, we can meet at least 8 of these sustainable goals. So how like we can assure the soil health? We are aware of this, that if we keep on adding nutrients in the form of chemical fertilizers, we are increasing imbalance in the soil ecosystems. And this imbalance is leading to severely affect the soil health. So we need to reconsider and relook into the nutrient, how we should make nutrient available to the plants and crops. So soil, I think harnessing soil-plant microbe interaction is the most important solution. Here we can harness the microbiome in a way that the plants will get their nutrients and the soils will not be affected by the continuous application of chemical fertilizers. In the last few years, with the advent of next-gen sequencing, microbiome research have brought a revolution in the way we think about human health. We are, every day we are reading one or another articles in newspapers or in blogs or in different platforms that how microbiome can shape human health and even human psyche. So similar way, but we are also aware that by using many antibiotics, we have microbiome human gut, and by applying some many antimicrobial soaps and solutions, we have disturbed the skin microbiome too. In the same way, we have also invested in biota, which is essential to plant health, by overuse of chemical fertilizers, chemical fungicides, herbicides, pesticides, and by our failure to add sufficient organic carbon back to the soils. Heavy tillage, which is mechanical tillage by using machines, also lead to the decline in microbial diversity. I'll show you one of our example study wherein long-term tillage practices and nutrient management practices, including chemical fertilizers, lead to the reduction of microbial diversity. Soil bacteria and fungi serve as the stomach for the plant. So the way we have our gut and the microorganisms which are present in our gut, they perform very different kinds of services for the host. Similarly, the plant, the soil microbes which are present in the soil, they also help plant by performing various function, diverse functions, and provide nutrients, protect pathogens, and also make it stress tolerant in many occasions. Soil microorganisms nourish and protect plants, and they play crucial role in providing many ecosystem services that are absolutely critical for human survival. So if we look into the soil systems, we saw that if we keep on adding and we or keep on harvesting a particular nutrient or a particular crop in a agriculture system, that may lead to the that may create imbalance in the soil and might reduce a particular nutrient, or will lead to the increase in population of a deleterious pathogenic microorganisms. So what are the solutions now? So plant soil microbes interactions, how we can harness those plant soil microbe interactions. So to harness those plant soil microbe interaction, we have to understand the phytomicrobiome, the microbiome of the plant. The way we human have a microbiome, which consists the organisms in our skin or in our gut or in any other part of our body. Similarly, plant also host variety of organisms inside and on its surfaces. So cumulatively, these communities of microorganisms make a phytomicrobiome. These microorganisms are, plant selects these microorganisms according to the requirements. So it's, in most of the cases, it's the plant which shapes the microbiome. If you look into the bulk soil in this figure, you'll see that the microbiome, the communities in the microbiome are different from the communities in the rhizosphere. And similarly, when you go up to the root endosphere, which is looking into the endophytic microorganisms in the root system, you see there is further reduction in the bacterial diversity and enrichment of a particular type of taxa or phylum. And these microorganisms, they are also found inside the above ground parts and on the surfaces of the plants. The microorganism which lies on the surface of the plants are considered location is known as phylosphere, and there are variety of microorganisms which are member of this phylosphere too. What kind of role these microorganisms play if we look into this below ground and above ground situations? So we can easily divide the above ground part a phylosphere and the below ground part a rhizosphere. And the microorganisms in the phylosphere and rhizosphere, they perform both beneficial and few might be harmful to the host plant or to the human. They may also carry some human pathogens. So when this crop is harvested and processed for the human consumption, it is likely that crop produce might contain some harmful microorganisms, which can be enteric pathogens or fungal spores. So further looking into this plant microbiome microbe interactions, so there, if we look close into the plant microbe interaction, the plants associated microorganisms can provide benefits to the plant through various direct and indirect mechanisms. So in this figure, I have shown that plants release root exudates in the rhizosphere, and the microbial community respond to that, and utilizing those root exudates, the specific kind of type of microbial community is attracted and it thrives there and perform various functions, which includes solubilization of various minerals and making them available to the plant or releasing it into the ecosystem in the rhizosphere. And then with the help of fungal symbionts, which are like arbuscular mycorrhizae, the plants can trap these freely available nutrients, and other members which are not indirectly linked, they enter inside the plant systems and form symbioses. They include arbuscular mycorrhizae in case of fungi, and in case of bacteria, there are many nitrogen fixing bacteria which enters into symbiosis, especially with the leguminous crops. And these nitrogen fixing bacteria, they fix nitrogen, and in return they get a place to multiply, and carbon sources or the energy source from the plant systems. So in this figure, you can see that the microorganisms and plants, when they interact with each other, there is a lot of signaling which happens. And this way, this signaling and these molecules which are released and which are uptaken by the plant, they were translocated to different parts of the plant by this blue dotted line. You can see that all the nutrients can be transmitted, which are beneficial for the plant growth. And similarly, there are many stress-related molecules which are being secreted by these organisms, and they make these plants stress tolerant. So if you look into the stress ecosystem, stress mechanism of the plant, so ethylene production is one of the key response to the stresses, especially the abiotic stresses. Many bacteria, they produce ACC deaminase, and these particular enzymes inhibit ethylene productions, and that way it controls stress tolerance in the plant. Many organisms, many rhizospheric organisms and phylospheric organisms, they also protect the plant from pathogens in very various ways, by by competition, by releasing cellular lytic enzymes, by antibiases, and many other ways. Microbiome mediated benefits can be initiated in any part of the plant, generally because most of the exchange of nutrients and other things happens in the rhizospheric below ground. So majority of the nutrients and biomolecules are transmitted from roots to the upper parts of the plant. So we know now that microorganisms, they play various roles, beneficial and harmful, for the plant when they are going on the thriving on the plants. So it's become very essential to understand how this microbiome originates. So if you look into this, many of the microorganisms, they can be transferred vertically from the seeds. So it's like from the parent, it can transfer to the seed and then to the next crop. But seed mediated transmission is not very much in case of plant microbiome. So majority of the microbiome, it comes from the surrounding environment, which includes soil where the plant is growing, and the phylospheric and the above ground part, the microbiomes comes from the generally from the air or the soil dust. So these microorganisms, in many cases it has been studied that even from the root systems, the microorganisms enters into the root as endophyte, and it translocates from the root to the shoot part. And in this particular way, many human pathogens can also translocate to the upper part of the plant. So, as I already discussed, that root plant release root exudates, and their presence triggers the presence of microorganism triggers the plant to release specific root exudates, and these microorganisms then start colonizing. So, especially in case of endophytes, the plant, its immune system and its system to control it put sanctions on the microorganism and do not allow different kind of microorganisms to enter. So it selects very specific kind of microorganism into the their endosphere. So if we are aware of this, that there are microorganisms which are inside the plant, which are good for plant. So if we want to harness this plant microorganisms, so what are the approaches available? In the past, people have used various approaches, which includes using single nucleus inoculants based formulations, making formulations by just using one plant growth promoting bacteria or fungi, or by making multiple consortia of one or two or maybe four or microorganisms and combining them and putting them back into the system, may it be spray on the leaf system, leaves, or by drenching it into the soil or by coating the seeds. So these were the classical procedures people were performed using till now. But with the advent of this microbiome-based studies, with the new knowledge of microbiome-based studies, now we can understand the microbiome and then target the isolation of specific atmospheric microbacteria and design synthetic communities by considering the correlation among the specific organisms. So if these organisms, if you are making a consortia or synthetic community, these organisms should work in a synchronized way. They should not inhibit each other, and they should help the plant, the organisms which are directly beneficial to the plant in establishing there. So many times it has been studied, witnessed, when you put a single inoculant or a combination of microorganisms, many times this combination of microorganism or single inoculant, it fails in multiplying there or establishing in the rhizosphere or in the phylosphere. So to make this system fail-safe, this synthetic community-based approach by harnessing the core microbiome. Core microbiome is something which where you, by using microbiome-based approaches, you understand, you find it out that what are the key microorganisms which are always present in the association of this particular crop plant. Because studies have suggested that plants, different crop plants can can select very specific kind of microorganisms. So it is not like that every plant can have similar kind of inoculant or similar kind of microbiome. So these plants, they select very unique communities based on the requirements in the particular soil they are growing, in a particular environment they are growing, and utilize them for their purposes in those soils. In particular, if you say that in a particular soil the nitrogen levels are low, so the micro the plants will try to attract microorganisms which can fix nitrogen for these plants. If phosphorus is an issue, if the available phosphorus is not there, so there is a possibility that these plants will release certain exudates or certain signals which will trigger the microorganisms to which has the ability to solubilize phosphorus. So this kind of interactions, if we can understand, so this suggests us that every plant and every agroclimatic region might have a diverse or different core microbiome. So our strategy will be to develop synthetic communities by understanding the core microbiome and including microorganisms which are not just efficient plant growth promoting bacteria, but we should also provide microorganism which can support these beneficial microorganisms to establish in the niche, may it be phylosphere or may it be the rhizosphere or in the endophytic situation. And these organisms should not, they should suppress the plant pathogens. And there are, by using this approach, we can develop a fail-safe approach for microbial inoculants. So there is, we can also, there is, because if you look into the microbiome research or biology research as a whole, most of the studies are being done in human system because it's there is a bigger demand for this area of research. So we can take some clues from human microbiome studies that how people are using human microbiome and then try to develop protocols and procedures which we can use in a similar way in the plant microbiome interactions. So in situ microbiome manipulation is a way wherein we can manipulate the microbiome by using prebiotics, by providing certain biochemicals or some certain kind of food material for the microorganism, which will stimulate the growth of or multiplication of this specific microorganism, which should be beneficial. So, and then we can introduce a new microorganism, which can trigger cell-to-cell signaling and increase the population of these beneficial microorganisms. Or we can use bacteriophages or some other way, we can use some other microorganisms which can remove the deleterious organisms from the system. So we are not adding the microorganisms here the way we proposed in the previous slide. Here we are proposing that if we can do some manipulations by adding some molecules or by adding certain type of microorganisms or bacteriophages, so we can remove a pathogen or we can trigger the beneficial organisms. So this approach can be applied in the plant ecosystem, plant microbiome interactions also. So now I'm coming back, coming to our studies wherein we perform that how pea plant shapes its microbiome, especially for nutrient uptake and stress amelioration. So this study we conducted in collaboration with ICR Institute at Shillong, wherein there is a big plot of experimental plots wherein they were maintaining these plots by conservation agriculture approaches. Conservation agriculture approaches consists of different tillage practices, which include the normal tillage and then minimal tillage by applying simpler tillage practices or by using no tillage. So there were three different tillage practices they were performing, and then they were using different nutrient management practices too. So now the question arises, why Northeastern region is selected for this kind of studies? Because Northeastern region till now is not, Northeastern India is known for its complex, diverse and risk prone and fragile hills and degraded plateau ecosystems. So the soils, it receive a lot of rain, especially in Shillong region. And due to rain, there is a possibility that most of the soil it's get eroded, and the soils are not that rich in nutrients. And the other thing which is very important to notice there is majority of the soils in Northeastern region are acidic. The pH value in majority of these soils are below 5.5. So what happens when the soils are acidic or alkaline? So if you look into this figure, so you can see that in acidic soil, majority of the nutrients are important for like what we call them macronutrients, including nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium, and sulfur, they become scarce. And if they become scarce, plant cannot uptake them. And when there is an increase in alkalinity, the pH increases, then many trace elements, they become scarce. So in addition to the decrease in micronutrients, in acidic soil, we have another challenge of increase in certain micronutrients. So in this case, you can see that iron concentrations increases tremendously in the acidic environments. We don't have a bar for aluminium here, but aluminium also increases in acidic environments. So aluminium and iron, when they are in higher concentrations, they are toxic to the plant. And macronutrients are already deficient in this kind of soils. So cultivating plants in these soils or crop plants in these soils is really a big challenge. So if in this table, you can see that the pH, how the pH of these soils is. So majority of the soil, like 81% of the geographical, total geographical area in Arunachal and in the majority of the northeastern regions, except Assam. Assam has nearly 60% of the geographical area, which is under acidic soil. The remaining one is in neutral or maybe in alkaline range. So, but in other, all other states, you see it's more than 90% of the soils are acidic in nature. So to design an experiment, to conduct this experiment, the three tillage practices were applied and six different nutrient management practices were applied. And there was a rotation of rice and peas for both the cropping seasons. So in the, when the rice is cultivated, all the nutrient management practices were applied, like they applied 50% NPK, 100% NPK, they use in-situ residue, they also used wheat biomass, green leaf manure, and one organic treatment, which includes farmyard manure, wheat biomass, and rock phosphate. So I also want to mention here, when the soils are acidic, and as I told that in acidic soil, iron and aluminium get enriched. So these aluminium and irons, they form complexes with available phosphorus and make that unavailable to the plants. So adding rock phosphate is a very important step in these acidic soils, especially in the organic farming. Otherwise, NPK, it already includes phosphorus. So the workflow for this experiment was, we collected bulk and pea plants, we uprooted the pea plants and collected the rhizospheric soils. And for rhizospheric samples, we did multiple washings followed by a partial sonication so that we can collect the rhizospheric soils. And after collecting the rhizospheric soils, we pelleted down the soil biomass and extracted DNA and perform microbiome analysis by using amplicon sequencing of 16S RNA, V3 and V4 region of 16S RNA using Illumina MiSeq sequencer. And for processing, we use Kind pipeline. So this is the sequencing statistics we got. And you can see that we have almost similar number of sequence reads in both the rhizospheric and bulk soil samples. And when we performed this alpha diversity analysis, we found that bulk soils have much less diverse in comparison to the rhizospheric soils, especially in Shannon alpha diversity indices. So this is contrary to what people have reported previously in case of bulk soil and rhizospheric soils. But these plots are maintained for long-term field experiments, and they were utilizing, using a specific nutrient management practice and tillage practice. So it is likely that using a single practice for longer period, it's known that may lead to the reduction of diversity of microorganisms. When we looked into the beta diversity plots, so here we can see that the rhizospheric soils, when the plant is there and that we collect this rhizospheric soil, in those cases the shift in microbial community is low in comparison to the bulk soils. So bulk soils are more scattered and the rhizospheric soils are much compressed group or much compact group. At phylum level, when we looked into the relative abundance of these these microbial communities at phylum level, so we can see that majority in the bulk soil, the firmicutes are enriched, are the enriched, and then in the rhizospheric soil, the proteobacteria group or the phylum proteobacteria gets enriched. Overall, if we say, so phylum proteobacteria and formicutes are the most dominant phyla in both the soils, followed by acidobacteria and actinobacteria. So after this, we started looking into the differences in the abundance of formicutes, because we noticed that the formicutes and proteobacteria proportion changes in bulk soils and rhizospheric soils. So here we found that in bulk soil, we performed, this data is based on NGS sequencing, the left side one, and we also performed qPCR to validate our NGS data observations. So when we performed qPCRs, we got almost similar kind of trend that the microbial communities in the rhizosphere has much lower proportions of formicutes in comparison, or maybe half of the proportion of the formicutes in comparison to the bulk soils. Now, looking at the genera level, we found that the genera, bacterial genera, including Rhizobium, Acidibacter, and Nitrobacter, Geobacter, and Pentoia, Pseudomonas, were enriched consistently in the rhizospheric samples, whereas the abundance of Planomicrobium and I could not see this one, just a minute, and one more, so it increases in bulk soils. So when we looked into the shared and unique genera, so we can see that 95 genera were unique in bulk soils, and rhizosphere has 292 unique genera. So now we can think of that from where this genera, 292 genera are coming up. Because when I showed you this origin of microbiome, then I told that majority of the microorganisms come from the bulk soil or from the surrounding environment. So in the rhizosphere, soil is bulk soil is the surrounding environment. So it is likely that these members of these unique genera, which are specifically enriched in rhizosphere, so they might be present in very, very low amounts or in concentrations, and a sequencing method could not pick them up. And when the plant is there, in the presence of plant, when root exudates are there, so their populations get enriched, and they can be detected through the microbiome sequencing. So when we now we did this to know that what are the genera which are statistically abundant in different samples, like in bulk soils and rhizosphere soils. We found that Enterobacter are specifically enriched in rhizospheric sample, whereas Mycelia and Planomicrobium, they are specifically enriched in bulk soils, simultaneously Penibacillus. So looking into this, these organisms, that what could be their roles. So Rhizobium, it is also enriched in rhizosphere soil samples. It's a symbiont of peas, and its enrichment is something which is expected. And Nitrobacter, it oxidizes nitrite to nitrate, and which is a primary source of inorganic nitrogen for plants. Because in these plots, there is continuous input of nitrogenous fertilizers made through chemical fertilizers or through inorganic organic fertilizers, farmyard manure and all. So the presence of this bacteria indicates that these nitrates are being converted into nitrates so that plants can use them much efficiently. Pseudomonas and Pentoia, they are known for their plant growth promoting attributes, and they perform various functions. So their selection in the rhizosphere is quite evident. Similarly, Pseudomonas and Sphingomonas, they are also known for degradation of aromatic hydrocarbons and pesticides. So though they there is no treatment of pesticides, but there is a possibility that from the surrounding environment, some pesticides or some other kind of aromatic compounds interfere into the soil the sedimentary plot. Possible role of the specific genera which are enriched in the bulk soil. These are the Mesilia penibacillus planomicrobium. They are known for their extracellular secretion of enzyme amylases, cellulases, and hemicellulases. So, as I told you that in these plots, they were also using different substrate residues like green leaf manures, farmyard manures, and in situ residue retentions. So all these biological materials are still there in the soils, and these organisms might be using that and degrading them into simpler forms. So that's why they were more enriched in the non-rhizosphere or the bulk soils. Similarly, we can see that there were different genera which are differentially abundant in different tillage practices and in different nutrient management practices. So we also did some predictive analysis. So in this predictive analysis, what we did that we used those 16S RNA gene sequences and searched them into the text for fun database and try to figure out their potential functional roles. And based on those functional roles, we made this PCO plot. And we can see that the PCO plots of functional analysis is almost similar to the structural analysis. So the black ones are the rhizospheric samples and the brown ones are the bulk soil samples. So when we looked into these predictive functional profiles, so we can see that various genes were enriched in a particular type of sample. Like if you look into the this plot, majority of the bulk soil samples are on the positive side of the PC1, and majority of the rhizospheric samples are on PC negative side of PC1. So here we, if you look into the negative side of PC1, so all the metal tolerant genes including cobalt, zinc, cadmium resistant proteins and iron complex membrane proteins, they were enriched in the negative side in the samples which are on the negative side, all the rhizospheric samples. So we did the this analysis further, and we tried to figure it out that how these predictive functional profiles looks like when we take a single gene into consideration. So cobalt, zinc, cadmium resistant proteins, they were enriched in rhizospheric samples, and similarly many other factors like RNA polymerase sigma factors and aldehyde dehydrogenases, they were all enriched in rhizospheric samples. So in conclusions, P. rhizosphere is more diverse in comparison to bulk soil samples under conservation agriculture practices. Increase in proteobacteria was observed in rhizosphere samples, whereas formicutes were higher on bulk soil samples. Bacterial communities with functional traits leading to removal of metal toxicity and increasing nutrient availability are enriched in rhizosphere samples. So I'm just giving you a brief idea about, because I think now I'm approaching the last 10 minutes. So I'll give you a brief idea about our studies on population structure of P. rhizobia. So here in this particular part, we'll be focused on a single microorganisms rather than looking into the communities. So we collected samples from different agroclimatic regions isolated the rhizobia root nodulating bacteria, and this is the overall profile on the isolation of microorganisms, this P. rhizobia. So we collected 19 samples from Leh region, and which led to isolation of 81 samples. So in total, nearly 300 isolate from different agroclimatic regions. We collected samples from 6 agroclimatic regions, you can see here, and we use 2 different approaches for their initial preliminary identification. We use 6-ness RNA gene sequencing and MALDI-TOF based identifications. We found that MALDI-TOF based identifications are much better in perform much better in comparison to the 6-ness RNA gene sequencing, because rhizobium, the members of rhizobium, they have very little differences in their 6-ness RNA gene. So it's like highly conserved in this particular group of organisms. But when we look into their protein profiles, so they showed very many unique peaks. So we are in this plot, figures, I'm comparing 2 different strains of rhizobium. So based on their further analysis, we used ATP and TRAC gene sequencing for making this phylogenetic tree. And here we can see that there are diverse groups, diverse species of rhizobium nodulating peas in different agroclimatic regions. So especially the transhumanal region is highly diverse. I have mentioned that TH means transhumanal regions, and all other part like TGP is transgangetic plains, and western plateau and hill, WPH is western plateau hill regions. So from this, we selected a few of the organisms. Those were those appears to be putative new species because they were not showing any similarity to the previously reported species. So we sequenced their genomes, and we come to know that they could be new species. And based on this, we made this table. Herein, I can see that transhumanal region has quite a diverse strains of rhizobium, species of rhizobium, and we describe one of the species. It's rhizobium indicum from transhumanal region. It's a new species, and in all other places, especially in western Ghat, transgangetic plains, and western plateau and hill regions, rhizobium bangladeshensis. This is a species which is reported from Bangladesh. It nodulates Vizia faba there, and lentil. So this particular species is highly dominating in Indian different agroclimatic regions too. From eastern Himalayas, especially from the Shillong region, we could only find rhizobium valleys. This particular species also not previously reported for fixing nitrogen in symbiosis with peas. After this, we were interested to look into the why these organisms are so, like, few of these organisms are widely distributed and few are very unique in their distribution. They are especially present in few pockets in a particular region. So to understand this, we try to look into the different genes which can lead to the lifestyle adaptation of rhizobium from rhizosphere to the symbiosis, like how rhizobium can enter into symbiosis, how it get attracted towards rhizosphere and then towards roots as an endophyte, and then form the bacteriodites or the form a nodule. So we found that there are many genes which are specifically expressed, which are specifically required for a particular functions. So there are 17 unique genes which are specifically required in a rhizobium cell to colonize the rhizosphere. So similarly, there are 23 genes which are specifically required for root and entering into the root system. And there are 142 species to perform to form a nodule and entering into the nodule, and then bacteroids. Bacteroids is the form when bacteria enters inside the nodule and start fixing nitrogen. So based on this, this approach, we started looking into the various genes. Especially, we looked into motility and chemotaxis genes in P. rhizobia. And here, we sequenced genomes of six rhizobial strains, which were collected during this study. And here, we can see that this MHM7 is Rhizobium bangladeshensis. So this particular strain has consistently very high number of cell motility and chemotaxis related genes. And it also has very high number of ACC, acyl homoserine lactone synthase gene. So these particular genes are really very important for communication with the host plant. With this, I conclude that diverse species of Rhizobium nodulate peas, pea plants in different agroclimatic regions of India. We also noticed by geographic distribution among P. rhizobia, Trans-Himalayan region host much diverse rhizobial species, and Rhizobium bangladeshensis is the widely distributed species across different agroclimatic regions. And the genome-based analysis exhibited a number of cell motility and chemotaxis genes in the strains of Rhizobium bangladeshensis may provide it a genetic advantage to nodulate or more number of much wider regions. So with this, I would like to thank all the people, those who are involved in these studies. This is a picture of students, those who work with me in this particular program. And I also want to thank the funding agencies, which is DST, SERB, and DVT, and our collaborators from ICR Research Complex, Shillong, and definitely the director and head NCMR. With this, thank you. So back to Partha.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Your presentation is quite interesting and so informative. It proves that your knowledge passes in the field of plant sciences and how microbes interact with plant at rhizosphere. I hope you have enriched the scientific temper in all young aspirants who are about to take up their research and many who are carrying out their research in their respective research domain. Sir, we had a huge number of participants today throughout your talk, and we have some questions from them. Yes. I will forward one by one to you.
Yes.
Yeah. The first question is that is from Sivapriya. She asked that, could you please tell the efforts of Lepsella in agriculture?
Sorry, can you repeat it?
Can you please tell the efforts of Lepsella species in agriculture?
Klebsiella.
Yes.
Yeah. Klebsiella, yes. Though this genera is considered as a very serious bug for us humans, but if you look into the environmental samples or the organisms which are present in the environment, the members of Klebsiella genera, so they are many times very like they perform very many functions for the benefit of the plant. If I remember, it's the first organism from which nitrogen fixing the whole complex of nitrogen fixing gene was cloned. So many members of Klebsiella, they have this nitrogen fixing abilities, and the organism which we also isolated in our lab, though it is from tomato skin, but it also have complete cluster of nitrogen fixing gene. So it can fix nitrogen And it can also perform any other plant growth promoting functions like IEA production and ACC demnase. So many functions have been reported from the members of Klebsiella, which are from environmental samples. Definitely, while proposing them as a biofertilizer or as a bioinoculant, well, I think it's always better to look them for their pathogenicity. It's very important because there are many reports wherein people found that microorganisms originated from plant or the plant produce may lead to various human infections. So there are many outbreaks in European countries wherein the microorganisms, especially the members of E. coli and Klebsiella, this whole Enterobacteriaceae family, they cause various diseases. So before you use them as a biofertilizers, it's always wise to check their pathogenicity for human.
Yeah, the next question is that, what about viruses, phytoplasma, spiroplasma? Why we don't find them in the phytomicrobiome group?
They are. Phytomicrobiome, I told, like, I didn't mention the name of the organisms there, but phytomicrobiome includes all the organisms which can be harmful, which can be beneficial. If you look into a healthy crop plant microbiome, definitely you will not get, or you'll get very few members which could be pathogenic for the plant, because the plant is already healthy and there is a mechanism, or the plant is already controlling the pathogens for proliferation in the plant system. So in healthy plants, it's very unlikely that you'll get very high number of these pathogenic phytoplasma and all other members. But if you look into a diseased plant, you'll get hell lot of these organisms, and your sequencing will tell you that your microbiome is like very much dominated by the pathogens.
Yeah. The next question is that, is there any connection in airborne species in Phyllospira with root exudates?
Okay, can you repeat it once again? I forgot the first one.
Yeah. Is there any connection in airborne species in Phyllospira with root exudates?
So you want to say that the root exudates can influence the phyllospheric communities? Maybe that's the question, I guess, if I could understand. Yeah. It's unlikely, because root exudates, they are released below ground, and the phyllospheric community, it is the surface of the leaves generally. So it's it's very unlikely that root exudate will influence the phyllospheric organism. But root exudates, they do influence the rhizospheric microorganisms, because they release specific kind of signal molecules, or the molecules which can only utilize by a specific group of organisms to select those organisms. Phyllosphere, as I told, that majority of the phyllospheric organisms, they come from air or the dust particles which settles down in the phyllosphere. So they are totally different from the root exudates. So there is no direct correlation between phyllosphere and root exudates.
Yeah, the next question is that, how much the phytomicrobiome affects the overall yield of Indian agriculture system?
It's a big question, actually. Phytomicrobiome affects. So phytomicrobiome affects means it can be harmful, it can be beneficial. So in Indian agriculture system, I don't have any statistics right now, but phytomicrobiome, both beneficial and harmful, they have substantial effect on the plant growth and yield. So it's Right now, I cannot give you exact number that what's that in yield, but the effect is substantial. But majority of our agriculture system is driven by chemical fertilizers today, because there is a lot of subsidy in chemical fertilizers. So majority of farmers, they are using chemical fertilizer indiscriminately, and then so you cannot get the maximum benefits of those those beneficial microorganisms. To get benefits of those beneficial organisms, you need to provide a situation where they can proliferate and they can multiply and then benefit the plant or the crop system.
Does it possible only when the old system change into organic farming?
Yes, it's not that. Yeah, so that's again a big question, that is it conventional agriculture means chemical fertilizers versus organic fertilizers? So should we just go from chemical fertilizers to organic fertilizers? I think there is, the answer lies somewhere in between. We need to develop a strategies what we call integrated farming, wherein we can harness the benefits of microbiome and the organic inputs, and simultaneously we can make use of chemical fertilizers. The major issue with the application of chemical fertilizer is that they have been used they have been like indiscriminate use is the biggest concern. So what is happening when you keep on applying chemical fertilizers, you are just putting a particular nutrient into the system, and this continuous input change the whole biogeochemical cycle in that ecosystem. And when the biogeochemical cycle get disturbed, it's very difficult to bring it back. So if you use good organisms, like if you understand the environment and then manipulate the microbiome to reset that biogeochemical cycle system, so that's how you can use it. So it's integrated farming. I think that's the because India is a big country, and we have very big population to feed. We cannot go from conventional to organic. We have to use the integrated approach.
Yeah, the next question is that what type of microbiome occur if the agriculture land is grazing type?
Sorry, grazing
type.
Okay, terracing. It's okay. So it's terrace farming, I guess. Okay, is it?
Yeah. Maybe like that, I think.
Yeah. So because in many agriculture systems, so terracing is one of the way people do agriculture in especially in the hilly regions. So I don't like, there is no specific question answer to this, that how terracing will influence the microbiome, but it is something one can look into, because it is possible that the fields which are on the top of the terrace, they might have very different physiochemical properties. The soil may have very different physiochemical properties in comparison to the fields which are on the valley or on the slopes of the hills. So that there is a situation where we can look into, but I don't find any significant difference studies on this kind of question. But there are studies wherein people have studied impact of elevation gradients. So therein, yes, with the increasing elevation, you will find changes in the microbial communities. So in very higher elevation, fungal communities, diversity of fungal communities goes down, and in places in the lower elevations, you'll get more, because it's related to temperature and the inputs. So many things changes with the elevation gradients. So elevation is one factor which people have studied, but terrace farming is something, I think it's not very huge difference in the elevation. Therein, I think the physiochemical properties of soil, they might play a bigger role in designing in the micro communities.
The next question is that, can you please give an example of microbial concept here, which have been designed to help in boosting the growth of plants and also somewhere helped in suppressing the plant pathogens?
Oh, yes. So there have been many consortia which have been designed, like many bacteria, which includes members of Pseudomonas, members of Bacilli, members of fungi, Trichoderma. So all these kind of organisms are already being used by various researchers to suppress the pathogens. But there are many studies also wherein this like why this particular pathogen is increasing in a particular soil ecosystem. If you understand that, I think this way you can also manipulate the microbiome and strategies to manipulate the microbiome. One can control. So it's like in situ microbiome manipulation could be a future for the places where these pathogenic microorganisms are a problem. But yes, in a simpler way, people have tried various pathogens, various biocontrol agents, including these members of these genera which I described, to control disease management.
The next question is that, do Azospirulium and Acetobacter immobilize zinc?
Zinc, Azotobacter and Azospirulium. I have never come across this study, but there are these genera, they are known for their nitrogen fixation. So Azotobacter is a free living bacteria which live freely in the soil systems and fits nitrogen, whereas Azospirulium is a associative nitrogen fixers, like it forms close association with the root systems and fits nitrogen there. So zinc solubilization, I do not know. There might be some strains of some species of Azotobacter which can solubilize zinc. There might be some, but yes, in case of zinc solubilizations, we have noticed that mostly the gamma proteobacteria, the members of Pseudomonadaceae family, they are the major players in zinc solubilizations in general.
Yeah, the next question is that, is there any relationship between a kind of salt and a kind of plant response with a particular phytomicrobiome?
Salt, okay. I could not get the, what does this salt means, like?
They relate three aspects. The kind of salt with the response of a plant with the response of phytomicrobiome.
They are trying to correlate the salinity stress maybe, and if there is a different salt maybe.
The kind of salt is.
Yes, that could be something one can look into, but in general, people have seen that like in salt stress conditions, the microbiome changes, and especially in case of plant microbiome, when there is a salt stress, it will recruit microorganisms, those who can remove that salt and allow that plant to thrive and survive there. So, but I cannot comment right now that if you put a different salt and then you, it's a experiment one can perform, I guess. It's a experiment, one can design that you are putting different salts into a same plant or same plant. We are potting into different salts and then see how they behave, how it will change the microbiome or how the microbiome respond to different salts. I never came across any study wherein people have studied different salts. There might be some studies.
Yeah, that passes on to the next question. The next question is that only rhizobium bacteria are beneficial symbionts in pea, or any other bacteria or fungi can able to associate?
Yes, fungi is fungal symbionts like mycorrhizae. They are important aspect of symbiosis in leguminous crops and especially in case of peas. Other bacteria other than rhizobium, there are reports wherein people have found that other than rhizobium, many a times other than rhizobium, there are members of other genera present in the root nodules, but they are not symbionts. They might be present there, but they are not true symbionts. Symbiosis is something wherein there is a mutual exchange of goods. So in case of these organisms, which are endophytic in origin, they might be present in the nodules, but they might not be exchanging the way rhizobium exchange nutrients with the plant. So I think in case of bacteria, rhizobium is the symbiont. There are few reports, especially from Europe, that actinobacteria, few members of actinobacteria, they also reside inside nodules, and people have studied that they benefit the plant when they enters inside the root nodules, but they are not symbionts. They can benefit the plant, but symbiosis is very specific relationship or interaction, whereas benefiting by some indirect way can be like a cooperation, or you can call a different term for this. I'm not getting the expression for it, but this is not symbiosis.
Yeah. The next question is that how much time it takes to build up or modify the plant microbiome if we are using compounds in rice wheat cropping system?
How much time? Okay. Okay. So it's like if you're putting compost, how much time it will take to change the microbiome, or means how many times you have to apply compost so that you can see that the microbiome has been changed. Even single dose of compost may lead to change in microbiome. If the microorganisms which are there in the compost, they are beneficial to the plant, and they are not present in the native soil or the soil where you are cultivating this plant. So if you are introducing totally different community there, and many members of these communities are beneficial to plant, definitely it will establish very quickly. Because compost also have many organic matters, so it allows microorganisms to thrive and survive in much better way in comparison to if you put some other way, like you put directly microorganisms by making some liquid formulation or something. If there is no organic matter, so it is difficult for microorganisms to multiply there. But if you are putting it along with compost, the chances of getting it colonized are much more. So I cannot answer that how much time it will take, but yes, it will definitely change.
Yeah. The next question is that, can we improve the efficacy of isolated beneficial microbes through genetic engineering?
Yes. It's again a good question. And they have, like I told you, that people try to clone the nitrogen fixation cluster from Klebsiella, and then try to express it in E. coli. So these studies happened in 1980s. But what happens when you try to manipulate these microorganisms and then you try to put them in the soil ecosystems. So in those conditions, you are making something, because if you are just putting a gene which is beneficial, then it is good. But if you are putting some other genes, like some marker genes or something, so then it is little difficult to say that you get the approvals. And genetically modified microorganisms and their application in agriculture, it's very far dream, I guess, because we are not yet, we are not accepting the genetically modified crops. So genetically modified microorganisms in fields is something very difficult. But yes, it can. It has been proven that, especially in case of phosphate solubilization, people have overexpressed PKQ genes and GDH genes, glucose dehydrogenase genes, and to increase the phosphate solubilizing potential of the microorganisms. So studies have been done to increase the genetic potential of the microorganisms, and this is something we are also looking into. That if we can say that, okay, the different species of rhizobia, they have differ in their chemotaxis genes or motility genes. So if we can introduce chemotaxis and motility genes in a very efficient nitrogen fixer, which fixes very higher amount of nitrogen, so that is something we can think of in future, that that might happen. But again, this science is little bit is not like, it's not attractive for scientists to pursue this kind of science, because at the end of the day, if they come up with a product, that product might end up in their lab tables only. It will never go to the fields. So that's why.
Yeah, the next question is that, can herbicides and weedicides kill microbes?
Yes, there are many studies wherein people have studied that the impact of application of herbicides and pesticides in the native microbial communities. And there are significant amount of evidences wherein these kind of changes in microbial communities have been noticed. So that's why if you want to get approval for the release of a new pesticide or a new herbicide, there are requirements that you have to study the impact of these herbicides and pesticide on the community, that how it affects. But most of the time, these studies are like very vague. People go with the isolation based approaches. Those approaches will not give you the real picture. If you do a microbiome based study and then look into the community levels, that how it is changing the communities, then you'll get the real answer. And yes, it changes the microbial community, affects microbial communities tremendously.
The next question is, what is the impact of endophytic fungi on plant pathogen resistant?
Impact of
what? Endophytic fungi on plant pathogen resistance.
Plant pathogen resistance. Okay. Again, I'm not able to give you the precise answer to this because it's an entirely different topic, maybe. But if many endophytic fungi or many endophytes are known for triggering the immune system of the plant, that by that way they make the plants more resilient to withstand the pathogen attack. So there have been studies and there have been many reports wherein many endophytic bacteria, endophytes mean something which is inside plant system, but it do not harm the plant. So plant is still healthy. The microorganism is inside that plant and plant is still healthy. So you can imagine that if that kind of arrangement is there, so definitely this microorganism, the plant which is harboring this organism as an endophyte, so they must have some communication in between them. And based on that, the plant allowed that bacteria or fungi to enter inside there, thrive there, and multiply there. And those different kind of jobs for it. Many times these endophytes are plant growth promotory by producing hormones, phytohormones, and many times they induce the resistance also against the pathogens.
Yeah, the next question is that fungi like Boveria, Bassania, and Metarhiza anisophile can protect the plants from insect or pest.
Yes, there is plenty of evidence on using these biocontrol agents, and these two organisms are frequently being used by farmers. If you and many like startups and small industries, they multiply these organisms and then they sell it to the farmers in very lower prices, and they are really effective in many cases. But it's not like they will be there is not a single solution for all different kind of insects. So I don't remember that which group of insects it's really affects, but definitely it's, I think, the insect which feed or they use the sap or something. So I don't remember exactly the specific type of insects which are controlled by these biocontrol agents. But yes, they have been used tremendously.
Yeah. Is there any alternative for farmers to protect the microbiome instead of using chemical sprays?
There are alternatives, but the thing is, yes, because this microbiology research in agriculture is quite old. In 1960s, if you look into the history of Indian agriculture systems, this developing biofertilizers and biocontrol agents started in IARI campus Pusa, and many of these biocontrol agents and biofertilizers were imported from Russia that time, and people started using them instead of chemical fertilizers. They were like two different approaches people were using. One approach was the conventional fertilizers, chemical fertilizer and pesticide, which is which brought us the Green Revolution. Simultaneously, there were people, those who were adopting a very conservative approach and trying to develop biological solutions. But somehow they could not be that effective the way those chemical fertilizers and chemical pesticides were. So that's why at the end, farmers, they got attracted more towards chemicals in comparison to biologicals. But with the increasing information now, with the increasing knowledge on microbiome research, and then different ways of manipulating microbiome or applying microorganisms, this research will again come back, and yes, this will be the future for agriculture. Biologicals will be the next future for agricultures.
What are the effects of chemical fertilizers on microbial population?
Chemical fertilizers. Yes, chemical fertilizers, they really, really change the microbial community. Like if you're using like ammonia-based fertilizers or nitrate-based fertilizers, definitely the nitrogen fixers population will go away, because plant will now not support them because they are already getting nitrogen from the chemical fertilizers input. So this is one thing. And the other thing is the organisms which thrive or multiply in lower nitrogen conditions, they also get affected, and their population will also go down. And on the other side, the organisms which can utilize or which can thrive on these nitrates or ammonia-based fertilizers, they will increase in their number because they are getting a very high doses of food for them. So their number will go up. But on the contrary, the organisms which fix nitrogen, or they love nitrogen-free environment, or they survive in nitrogen-free environment, their number will go down.
Yeah. The next question is that, does the pH of the soil is determined by the presence of macro and micronutrients, which severely affect or has an impact on phytomicrobiomes?
Okay, so the question is, the pH of soil is affected by micronutrients, and it lead to the effect on phytomicrobiome. Okay,
yeah.
I got it right. Okay, it can be two way. Yeah, it's like when the pH is high or low, the micronutrient availability will change. I don't know if you increase micronutrients, yes, that definitely will affect the pH conditions, but how effective it will be and how much input of those micronutrients is required. But macronutrients like nitrogen-based fertilizers, they definitely change pH. If you keep on adding nitrogenous fertilizers, it will lead to acidic environment. So that kind of observation has been noticed. Yeah. And that definitely lead to the change in microbiome, because the organisms which are thriving in low pH, the neutral pH, they will not thrive on the acidic pH now.
Yeah. The last question before you leave, from your conceptual theories, you said that certain bacteriophages can be used to target the plant pathogens.
Yes.
Is there any research based on this?
The only, I must say, hiccup in this area of research is that bacteriophages are very, very specific. So developing getting a bacteriophage which is like little broad spectrum, which can not be like, and the microorganisms, they get resistant to bacteriophages very instantly. So getting a bacteriophage which is very efficient in removing these pathogens, that's the key. If you get this kind of strain, so it can be used very efficiently. But bacteriophages are being used in environment in many cases. They are not very much efficiently used in agriculture system yet, but the future is because something which happens in medical science or in the human systems, it the agriculture scientist and the soil scientist, they also get inspired from those findings, and they try to look into that way also. But as I was telling you, that in environment people are using it, like in case of oil extraction places. So there is an increase in sulfur reducing bacteria many a times, and then people are using these approaches of using bacteriophages to reduce the number of sulfur reducing bacteria there, and then getting the pipelines. So they are saving the pipelines that way. So in environment, people are using it. So there is no harm in using it in agriculture system also. It should be functional. That's the only requirement, I guess, for any technology. If the technology is functional, it's working fine, it will be adopted in any system. And it should be, in case of agriculture, I think it should be little. Cost is a big factor again. If the cost is not very high, because bacteriophages, multiplication and everything, and application. So right now it is being used in high-end jobs where the impact is very high. But the way biotechnology research is moving ahead, I guess in future it will be used in the natural agriculture systems also.
The next question is that, sir, from root exudates, by using root exudates, pathogenic microbes too enters the plant system. Why don't we use certain synthetic root exudates in outer rhizobia to resist your pathogen entry into the plant system.
Okay. Yes, this is the approach which I told you that in situ microbiome manipulation, that you apply, you provide some biochemicals, some signal molecules, or some kind of inputs, may it be a bacteria, may it be a biome like siderophore, because or some other signaling molecules which trigger the beneficial organisms to multiply and activate the beneficial microorganisms there, and then remove, they can fight back the deleterious pathogens. So it's very well possible, and people are trying to look into these areas now, and by applying, so there is new concept of using nanotechnology in agriculture, wherein you use some nanomaterial to trigger different things, including the microorganisms, to multiply and then remove the pathogens. So it's possible.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir, for your time and your patience in listening and answering our questions. I hope participants are satisfied with the speaker's elaborate explanation in answering all your questions. Thank you so much for participants. And I thank our speaker of today's session, Dr. Praveen Rahe, for spending your valuable time with us. And I extend my sincere gratitude to you on behalf of my entire team of Biomix. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, yes. Whole team, and to all of your audiences, those who have asked so many questions, and I am really overwhelmed with these questions. They are really very relevant questions for plant-microbe interactions and the future agriculture. So thank you. And thank you for giving me to interact with these wonderful guys. Thank you.
It's always a pleasure. Thank you so much. I once again thank everyone who joined with us. A few announcements to the participants. Our next session is scheduled tomorrow at 6 p.m. IST. The speaker of this session would be Dr. Vivek Prakash, who is a research scientist in the University of Texas at USA. And he will be delivering his talk on exploring alternate scientific career tracks in post-COVID economy. So the registrations are still open. You can still register in the website of Biomix. Thank you so much. We expect more registrations. We will be closed tomorrow evening. And thank you so much. Stay connected with the Biomix team for further updates. Join with us. Stay tuned. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.